Thank you for joining us for today's meeting of the DNC Rules and Bylaws Committee. I am Jim Roosevelt, and I serve as the co-chair of this committee, normally alongside my distinguished colleague, Lorraine Miller. Lorraine is unable to attend today due to some health issues of members of her family. This was also true at our last previous meeting. Lorraine has always dedicated her whole heart to her work with the Democratic Party. She does not feel that she's going to be able to dedicate the time and attire for this important process as we move forward this year, while balancing the need of her family, which always comes first. So she hopes to see all of us soon, to speak with each of you in person, but she does want you to be aware that she has been in touch with the chair, and we are expecting her resignation from the committee. This is, for me personally, a great loss. She was great. Just a great Democrat, but also a great leader within the DNC and his party. We do not yet have a replacement, but I thought it was important to make you all aware of this situation. I've talked with Lorraine myself and told her how grateful I am for the work that she's done and how wonderful it has been to work alongside her. I also tried to talk her into staying on this committee, either as co-chair, take a little break, or as just a member of the committee, but not co-chair. And she just says that given the health situation of her family member, she just cannot do it. So that's where we're at.
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
Can we all just take a minute and just applaud Lorraine? We just can't say she's great.
Here.
Mr. Mitchell?
Here.
Ms. Moore?
Ms. Mount?
Present.
Mr. Ray has given his proxy to Mr. Roosevelt. Mr. Saunders?
Here.
Mr. Spate?
Here.
Ms. Swecker?
Here.
Mr. Thompson?
Here.
Ms. Weingarten?
Here.
Ms. Williams has given her proxy to Ms. Lewis. You certainly have more than the quorum of 13, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Helen. We do have a quorum. For our charter and bylaws, a quorum is 40% or 13 members present in person or by proxy. Before we begin, I want to recognize the team who works behind the scenes to make sure we do what we need to do and everything runs smoothly. In addition to Helen, we're joined by members of the party affairs staff. Our new, but it seems like forever, director, Veronica Martinez. Our special assistant, Jenna Whitaker, our former director and longtime advisor to the Department of the Party, Rick Boylan. The secretaries of caucus. Round of applause, that's great, yes. Raise issues that are important to all of you, see where we may need to request additional information from staff. Discussing the rules governing the delegate selection process is a pretty broad assignment. So to keep us organized, I'd like to start by laying out the key pieces that we tend to take on each cycle, and then hear from our state party leaders about how these rules are implemented in their states. I'm also interested in learning how the committee might want to incorporate virtual aspects from the 2020 cycle into the 2024 rules, a point that Artie Blanco raised at the March meeting. There's a lot of ground to cover this afternoon, but we have plenty of time, so please don't hesitate to jump into the conversation. Anything we don't cover today, we can roll into tomorrow's discussion. Tomorrow's continuation of this meeting will include a presentation on ranked choice voting that was requested at the March meeting. We'll also discuss bonus delegates as raised by Frank Leone in March. Finally, you'll notice that I did not mention the resolution honoring and reaffirming the importance of the six basic elements that Harold Ickes had submitted. This resolution had been deferred to this meeting. Harold contacted us on Sunday, asking to withdraw his resolution. As such, without objection, we will remove consideration of that resolution from the agenda. Does anyone have any general questions about what we're going to be covering today or tomorrow? So, not hearing any questions, we'll just move to the next item on the agenda, and that's with regard to the Charter and Bylaws Working Group. As you may recall, the bylaws charge us, our committee, with conducting a continuing study of the rules, or current study of the rules, including a regular review of the Charter and Bylaws. In March, we shared that along with our committee's work on drafting the 2024 delegate selection rules and the call for the 2024 National Convention, we pulled together a small group of interested members to conduct the review and bring recommendations back to the full RBC. At that point, we will determine whether to move forward with recommending proposed amendments to the Charter and Bylaws for the summer DNC meeting. The working group will meet over the next few months and will bring their recommendations to us at the June RBC meeting. So that's for the June meeting. And that'll be, they'll bring the recommendations for the June meeting, and if we take action on them, it'll be at the July 15 and 16 RBC meeting. We had asked RBC members to indicate if they had an interest in being part of the working group. We also wanted to keep this group small so that it can effectively determine the recommendations for the full committee. As an RBC member, you'll be able to fully discuss any recommendations that are made by the group. I'd like to thank Artie Blanco, David McDonald, Stuart Applebaum, Frank Leone, Leah Dockery, Carol Felder, and Tanya Williams for agreeing to serve as members of the working group. And we've asked Carol Fowler to chair the group. Before we move on, are there any questions about the working group and that review? Okay. So you've all received the schedule of meetings for 2022, and I wanted to share my thinking on the general business we'll conduct at each meeting. Of course, this overview won't encompass everything we'll discuss. It might change as we go along, but I want to make sure we're all on the same page of where we're generally headed. Our next meeting will be a virtual meeting. It'll be on May 18. Based on the resolution before us today, by the time of our May meeting, we will have already notified states of the opportunity to apply to be considered for a pre-window exemption. During that meeting, we will discuss the process for reviewing applications and continue our discussion on the delegate selection rules. Because we will begin those discussions today and tomorrow, we should be in a good place in May to start the actual drafting process. Our meeting on June 22 to 25 will be in person here in DC. I don't think we're going to necessarily meet all 3 days, but it's going to be within that window. Right, without that. You might be all 3 days, but I don't That's true. Depends on how many states apply and how extensive our discussion is. At that meeting, we will continue our drafting process as well as consider early window state nominations. At our meetings in July, on July 8 and 9 and July 15 and 16, this committee will determine the early states and finalize the proposed 2024 delegate selection rules. Yes. So that's our July meetings on July 8 and 9 and July 15 and
16. Those are in person.
Those are in person, yes. We haven't decided yet where they will be. They're not in conjunction with the DNC meeting, so we have some more flexibility. Don't know if there'll be an executive committee meeting in conjunction with one of those or something like that. But we might move one to another location. Okay. So at those meetings in July, we will determine what the early states are, and we will finalize the proposed 2024 delegate selection rules. At the August 5 and 6 meeting here in DC, we will finish drafting the 2024 call for the convention. So you can see you can plan all your reach time around these RBC meetings. The proposed rules of call will be sent to the DNC membership for consideration at the summer meeting, which is expected to be later in August. I know these are very broad strokes that I'm giving you, but I want to be sure you're aware of our mile markers as we move toward drafting the rules of call that reflect our party's values. Please don't hesitate to contact me or the PAD staff if you have logistical questions. Any questions at this point? Sure. The July dates are July 8 and 9 and July 15 and 16. You didn't miss any of that, yeah.
I apologize for interrupting.
So you all hear the request from our recorder.
Please, thank you.
Yes, please.
You're going to find in the month of July, especially for a number of unions, we're starting up our conventions again. We have a national convention as well, which really takes 2 weeks out of that month, and that would conflict with the dates that you just provided. So just be prepared for that. And so the numbers won't be around.
So I'm not sure that is a factor that we really were fully aware of. Let us go back and look at this with that in mind. Given how much I like where the teachers are doing their convention, where's your convention?
Philadelphia.
I like Philadelphia too, but anyway. Okay. All right. So please feed all these ideas into staff. We will do whatever we can. So at the, I'm sorry, yes. So that was Lee Saunders a minute ago. Let's try to remember to say it right before we speak, okay? At the August 5 and 6 meetings in D.C., we will finish drafting the 2024 call for the convention. The proposed rules of call will then be sent to the full DNC membership. So, let's talk about the virtual listening sessions. In addition to our meetings, there are four virtual listening sessions that we encourage members to attend. Listening sessions like this have historically been very important to past delegate selection processes, both for that process, also for the platform and other party activities. We intend to roll these sessions out regionally. They will take place, I'll say this a little bit slowly, on May 5th, May 16th, May 25th, and June 1st. Our staff will be reaching out to all of you to confirm your availability, and I encourage you to attend at least one session, if you can do that. These sessions will feature a range of speakers who will offer thoughts on the nominating process. As Susan Swecker mentioned at our last meeting, these listening sessions should not be confused with the state presentations to this committee. With regard to the early window. I'll add that they should not be treated as a lobbying opportunity for states interested in going before the window. Rather, the listening sessions are a formalized opportunity to hear from our friends and our partners in the democratic ecosystem and ensure that the process we are building is inclusive of the thoughts and values of all Democrats. While the time for the listening sessions will be limited and it's likely to be impossible to feature all the speakers who are interested, we need all of your help to ensure that folks are aware of these sessions and that our constituencies are represented. Staff will be reaching out to you regarding this soon, but please don't hesitate to contact the PAD's office with any suggestions. The staff will let you know about any details regarding the meeting dates, times, and regions, their outreach to you, as well as how to share the name, contact information, and any additional information you'd suggest as prospective speakers for these sessions.
Jim, David, before you read that topic, are these public sessions actually public sessions where anybody from the public can speak, or are these by invitation only that the public can observe? In terms of the outreach I do, it kind of makes a difference.
So anybody from the public can attend. We will be, from the people who express interest, we'll be selecting who will speak at them. It's not going to be...
Speaking is by invitation only.
Essentially, by invitation to speak. They're not going to be total marathon sessions. Yes, Scott?
Scott from the Bylaws. Who's going to make the selection as to the speakers? What's the criteria?
So usually the co-chairs make the selection of the speakers. Any objection? Hearing none, that's how it will be. Yes, Ms.
Joanne Dowdell. Just a follow on, will we be, or will the state be, or anyone making a suggestion on who the speakers might be for consideration, and then you're selecting and inviting, or you will just...
Yes, so I am requesting that all of you give us suggestions as to who the speakers should be. Any other DNC member who would like to give us a suggestion would be great too, but particularly from members of this committee. Any other aspects of the listening sessions or details that you remember from previous listening sessions that you'd like replicated this time? All right, as we let you all know about the logistics and the timing and the exact locations and so on, that may inspire some other ideas as well, so please get back to us about those as well. Any further discussion or questions about all of that? Okay, so now on to the resolution that we began discussing at our March meetings. And it was sent to you in its current version last week in the package for this meeting. As a reminder, we requested a resolution that defined an overall framework for our pre-window process. And it referenced past commissions, delegate selection rules, and all of your comments from previous meetings. You'll see this reflected in the body of the draft resolution. You've each had an opportunity to review this resolution, and we have a copy available to you here if you need it, and it's up on the screen as well. So I'm not going to read it in its entirety. Rather, I'd like to highlight a few key components. This process sets a foundation for the 2024 presidential nominating calendar that is reflective of our party's values, builds trust in our institutions through transparency, sound processes, and puts us in the strongest position to retain the White House in 2024. It's built around an idea that members raised early on. It designs a framework for a pre-window that as a whole reflects our party's constituencies and values. We'll dive into what the timeline created by this resolution means for our calendar shortly. But to get our discussion started, I'd like to entertain a motion to adopt this resolution.
So moved.
Second. So moved by Stuart Applebaum and seconded by Ken Martin. Any opening discussion that anybody would like to raise? Yes, Mr. David.
I think Joanne Dowdell.
On page 5, item 4C, under feasibility, well actually, just in this section, will we be including more specificity under competitiveness? I guess I'm just concerned about the application process and how specific we will be around the details, and should that be included in some of that detail be expanded in this resolution? And also on feasibility, we talk about the cost and logistical requirements of campaigning in the state. Should size, state size, also be considered?
So let me take those in reverse order.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure, thank you. I think that the cost of logistical requirements is intended to encompass the size of the state, which affects both what it costs to run a campaign there and how long it takes to just get around. So I think those two factors of cost and logistics cover what we need. They're intended anyway to cover what we need to cover. And I think if we just say size, I mean, we could say, you know, that the state should be it should be geographically compact. Well, then we might do this from Rhode Island. But what I'd like to know is, what is the radio market cost there? And then we'll want to know about their demographics. And then by contrast, you look at somewhere where in Rhode Island you can get everywhere in 45 minutes. And in some states you can't get anywhere in 4.5 hours. So I think that's all encompassed there. On competitiveness, we've defined it up to a point. Does the state contribute to the party's ability to win in the general election? In other words, is it a test of will the candidate that is successful in one of those early states have a shot at winning nationally? That's what I think this competitiveness language means. It might well be that you pick a state where somebody will be overwhelmingly popular, but they're an outlier from the rest of the country. You pick somebody who's really good with sled dogs for Alaska early primary, something like that. That's not going to create a candidate that necessarily resonates nationally. So that's what we're trying to imply there, that from the characteristics of the state, is it a good test? And I think electoral history also is a factor there. Has the state chosen candidates in the past in either primaries or their caucuses? Who went on to win both the nomination and election. I think all of that can be taken into account as we look at this. So now we've just created a record. Okay. Carol Fowler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for creating that record. I want to be sure that, and I have one other question too, that record will be provided to those states that are that intend to apply for this, so they will know what we mean when we say cost and logistical requirements, or that they will know what we mean when we say competitiveness. That we are not necessarily saying that you are going to that our nominee is going to win that state by some huge margin or something like that. I just think this record that you have just created of definitions is important.
And I think we can. I agree, Carol. And I think we can draft some questions for the application that suggest to people what they want to address in their application. Some may choose not to address it, and some may choose to say, you see, whoever wins Guam is always elected president of the United States. You know?
And I did have one other thing when you say geographic diversity. In 2006, when we added two states to the early states, I think we were pretty specific about saying we intend to have a state from every region of the country. And if that's what we mean by geographic diversity, this committee ought to establish that among ourselves, that we intend to have a Midwestern state and a Western state and so whatever we intend by geographic diversity, or does that mean we can have two states from different parts of the South? I think we need to be a little clearer.
So certainly, if you look at our record, we have gone for the kind of geographic diversity that you just mentioned, a state from each overall region, sort of similar to our regional caucus regions. Northeast, or at least Atlantic, Southern, Western, and Midwestern. The general category, you know, using generic terminology, is geographic diversity. Frankly, I can't imagine that we would without very good reason deviate from that pattern. So we could even make this regional geographic diversity. I think we've had a little more general because you might say, well, one state should be more rural than some of the others, and one state should be more coastal or something, but I think regional really is the intention here. So why don't we amend that?
To say regional diversity.
Say regional.
I just remember that in 2006, South Carolina competed with Alabama for the southern slot. We didn't compete with Arizona for a general spot. And so we're going to do it. We just need to decide how we're going to do this. Do that, but I think we should make it clear that we're not going to have both Alabama and South Carolina.
Well, I think it makes sense to put regional into the definition here. We are not, you know, we're not creating a set of regulations that we have to follow. They're the factors that will be considered. So I think it makes sense to put that in. Ms. Brazil.
David, you not before me? Okay. Actually, I'm in the queue for a while before.
Yeah, it's true, and I forgot.
David, you don't for the
first. See, that's what happens when you don't have a co-chair.
I thought you had eyes in the back of
your
head. I actually had concerns in three or four areas, some of which maybe can be taken up by elaborating on the record. Some might require an amendment, but let me kind of work through them if I may. When I look at the criteria that we were just talking about, and particularly the diversity criteria, the use of the phrase ethnic diversity gives me some pause because I don't know, number one, I don't know what it means, but I also don't know who will read it as being excluded. And I'm wondering whether instead of ethnic diversity, we shouldn't just be saying included but not limited to the diversity required by Article 8, whatever section, whatever it is of the Charter. We have four in our existing rules. We have a long list of groups, such as the disabled, various communities of color, LGBTQ communities, most of whom would not think of themselves as ethnic. And rather than take a chance on missing somebody, if we just made a reference that we're going to consider the diversity that we always consider, and then we're also considering these other areas that would perhaps be better. My second area of...
Let's see if anybody disagrees with going to that one.
Well, that was the nature of my recommendation, that we say, but not limited to racial and ethnic diversity. I just want to be consistent. The way we stood back in 2006, where we've stood since the late 1980s, and I think we live in a multiracial democracy. Even the Census Bureau recognized that you have to add that component of racial and ethnic diversity. Now, we want to add the other categories that we have included, 5A, 5B, 5C, but I feel strongly that we continue to utilize racial and ethnic diversity.
I certainly agree with Donna that we want to make sure there's no misunderstanding about our commitment. I would worry that racial and ethnic diversity still doesn't include the disability caucus that we just added, other areas, and we may want to be more comprehensive. But I think anybody reading this should not have any doubts that we remain committed to improving diversity in the party
across technological perspective.
So ethnic and racial, and so improving ethnic, specifically including racial, makes a whole lot of sense. Going more broadly to all the categories that are in the charter probably is also worthwhile, as long as we recognize we're not going to do a statistical ranking here. It's not going to be, as we all know, as we always discuss it when we get to reviewing actual state plans, getting comprehensive, accurate numbers in every category is very hard. So we're not going to do that. But for us to be aware of the various facets of diversity in various states is probably a good thing. So
I take the point that you made earlier that we're not drafting regulations and we're not binding. And as a result, I think we ought to be clear we're going to consider all those factors. We're almost certainly going to have to make some trade-offs. There is no perfect group that represents the country as a whole in statistical sense. But just that everybody that's in the room will have to make some decisions, but everybody is being considered and not being left outside the consideration before we even get started. And I'll let staff or somebody come back with a suggestion.
I think we get the drift, and I think it makes sense, actually. By way of what you really just said, that we're trying to show everybody how comprehensive we're being in that consideration, not that we're trying to meet every possible requirement there.
My second concern is following a little bit along with what Joanne said a moment ago. I think we need to be clear that if I'm correct in what our approach is, then I think we need to be clear that we're talking, when we say competitiveness, we're talking about contributing to our ability to win the Electoral College in 2024. We're not talking about improving our competitiveness to win the state legislature and the reason I say that is because earlier in the year resolves, we talked about winning across the November ballot, which is very broad, but our actual concern, I think, in picking this up from states is, as you said, getting a nominee will win the general election, and that means winning the Electoral College. It may also mean looking at states where we could improve our chances, as opposed to looking at states where we know we're going to win the Electoral College because we won it there for the last 100 years. That doesn't improve competitiveness. That just
so you're not being out of Massachusetts.
Well, if you lost the last time, if I read the Price Urban Commission report, I'm just going to change that.
Right. So I get exactly where you're going. I think we can be a little clearer about that. It's not. Let us work on that language because we want to preserve the possibility of the unexpected.
Yes.
We've seen that happen. And you can even look at Massachusetts where Scoop Jackson won the primary one year. So,
and I'm sure he would still remember that he was the last.
He definitely would, yeah. Right. But so, we'll work on that. I think we get the drift of work.
Again, it's not absolute, but I think that is what. Certainly in 2006, when we made those final decisions, one thing we looked at was whether the states that we chose would possibly flip from being GOP electoral votes to Democratic electoral votes and improve our chances.
Well, okay, now I'm hearing something a little different when you say that from what I was thinking of before. One thing you're thinking is whether the state would flip from being having a Republican general electoral. I'm really thinking that what we're talking about here is whether the state is has a history of producing a nominee who would have a reasonable shot of winning the general election.
And if we didn't have the rest of the be it resolves, I might agree with you, but when we have a preceding be it resolved and a bunch of whereas, let's say, because of all the investment in the state, the organizing logistics that are done in the state as a result of our choice, I want to maximize our chance of winning across the November election ballot. There is a great risk of confusion, but we're not focused on presidential, but focused on something else. And so I'll let everybody come back to the suggestion staff, kick it around. But the thing I'm concerned about is that this later gets misread as, let's go to a solid blue state electorally, but where it might make a difference in the congressional race or something. That's not really the focus, as I understand.
Our focus is on winning the finance. That's going to be like your proposal, we'll see.
Then my next concern, I think, really is, I raised it before, and I just want to, I guess, have you clarify again, because it's not in there. When we talk about announcing the results of the preliminary evaluation, whatever it is, on page 5, paragraph 5, it says, as part of the notification, the RPC co-chairs will set the date to announce the result. I just want to be clear, we're announcing the results and the basis of the decision of the evaluation, as opposed to saying, we'll send you a note, but you don't want to the lottery, but don't ask us what the numbers were going to take.
Explain to me what you mean there.
Are we simply going to say the following states will be allowed to make a presentation, or are we going to say the RBC decided to advance the following states for further consideration because these factors were very strong, or something? Is there going to be some explanation, or is it going to be like at the Supreme Court when your writ of certiorari gets denied, it just gets denied, you know, to find out what it was?
So I believe that our history, Rick, you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that we just announced which states. We don't give the rationale when we do that. And, you know, the rationale is always going to be debatable because there are so many factors here.
But isn't it a bit inconsistent with transparency to say, we'll send a puff of smoke up and we'll let you know who the Pope was, but we're not going to know who the Pope is, but that sense would not be good. who the Pope is, but we're not going to tell you how to vote.
Well, we're not going to tell you what the factors were on why people voted that way. I think we get off into the weeds that way. My inclination is that we announce which states. If I hear your argument otherwise, but I think we're intending to end the debate rather than begin it at this point.
Well, I've expressed my concern. I'm not going to propose an amendment unless there are other people who have a similar concern. I do, and this is my last point, have one additional thing to raise, and this I will submit an amendment on. It is a bit concerning that we kind of are in this process by surprise. You know, that all of a sudden we have an RBC, and now we're talking about this process and reopening the window. It's not a surprise that we might consider it. It's a surprise that we're doing it right now. And all I'm going to say,
I don't really agree with that. We do this every 4 years.
We do not really consider reopening the window and setting up a process and taking applications every 4 years. We do review the rules every 4 years. And all I'm going to suggest, what I want to suggest is that perhaps we should make part of this resolution that at least once a decade, when we have the new census, we will revisit the demographics of the upfront window, the competitiveness of the states, and revisit the schedule, not sometime, but that we will commit periodically, and that was the most obvious period to me because we know something may have changed. We will take a look at this process so that people, both in the states that we put up front, know it's not something that's going to last forever unless they keep working at it. And so the states that are not in know that it's not written in concrete, and if they continue to build their base and get their states more competitive, that they might have a better chance the next time to look at it.
So, I have a point of view on that, but before I express it, I have a feeling Mr. Martin has something he wants to say that might
Well, not to this point, although I would say, thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. Not to David's point, although I would support his amendment if he had specific language to propose, but not to this point. I do have another item I'd like to raise.
Something else. So let me just say on this point, technically and legalistically speaking, all the rules are on the table every 4 years. They don't carry over. Okay. You're saying we don't always have a full discussion of what states will be early. It seems to me that's very much a matter of sort of the political context at the time. And I think it's very tricky for us to bind future DNCs or future RBCs to do that on a regular basis. I think the political situation kind of causes whether that rises up, and it's risen up this time. It might well not 8 years from now. So that if we put a regular, if we say at least every so often that will happen, I don't think we necessarily have the power to do that, to tell you the truth, because we're not, we're not going to be the people we're binding. So I think it's a good idea to do a regular review, and as it happens, we have somewhere in every decade we've done it, not always on a decennial schedule.
Part of my response would be, given that we've got 4 pages of history in this resolution, if we put something about reviewing things every decade into this resolution, it would go into history if the next resolution would just be about binding. And it would stand as an expression of the sentiment of this Rules Committee. And although we don't have the power to bind, we always have the power to recommend a bylaws and charter amendment that would bind the RBC and give all the states in the country an assurance that this would be periodically reviewed. We could put that into the charter if we chose. I'm not proposing it today because that's a more complicated discussion, but I think it would be good to get some idea of whether we think we should be doing this review periodically or whether we think we should just be assuming until enough votes are upset that we're going to continue with the same 4 states, because that's basically what we've been doing for the last 12 years, I think, because there's been a latent assumption, even though there's been some concern, that the states would stay up front. And with that background, what I was going to propose was that we add into the be it resolved, the section on page 4, as a new third paragraph, that the RBC will review the pre-window schedule for composition at least once every decade after the release of the census. At some point after the release of the census, because we're going back there after the release of the census. And I'll put that out for discussion. I realize staff may want to work on it. If there's traction for it, staff may want to refine it or improve it, but at least get a discussion.
That's a motion. Is there a second? There is a second. Who seconded it? Ms. Kamarck? That's correct. That's right. So we have a series of notes as to the things people wanted to further consider. This is the first thing actually proposed as a formal amendment. So appropriate to take that up at this point.
Well, I was acknowledging the reality that the wording may not be perfect, and I'll also indicate if for the purposes of the flow of your discussion, if you want to defer consideration of this and come back, I'll resubmit it at a later point in this meeting, or we can do it now. I'm fine with it. Whatever works for you.
Let's consider it a motion at this point, but we may actually at some point postpone final consideration of it for later. Mr. Martin, did you want to speak on something else?
Yes, something else.
All right, so let's complete this and then we'll come back, okay? Yeah, so
considering it as an actual amendment, would you repeat the language so we make sure we get it right?
I just got my lesson.
Of course.
To insert a new paragraph 3 in the be it further resolved that is in the lower half of page 4 of the draft resolution. The new paragraph 3 to read, the RDC will review the pre-window schedule and composition at least once every decade after the release of the census.
All right, so, Mr. Leone, do you want to speak to the amendment?
Yes, sir. Yes, Frank Leone. I agree with the chair's position on this. We didn't review the pre-window states in 2004 because of the census, and we're not doing it this year because of the census. I think that's just kind of an arbitrary trigger. The fact is we can review this every 4 years. We took a hard look at, after the concerns that were raised in 2008 with Michigan and Florida, we looked at it and we revised it, and then the last couple of cycles we haven't taken a hard look at it because there hasn't been that much concern. This time there was concern, so we're looking at it. So I think trying to set an arbitrary time when we should look at this, when in fact we have the option of looking at it every 4 years. And if we decide to do nothing about it, we're essentially looking at it and deciding to do nothing about it. So I think that process has worked well, and I don't see a need to set other boundaries on it.
Yes.
Hi,
Colin.
I guess that was part of my question, was what does review mean? Does review mean we look at it and say we're actually satisfied, we don't see anything that would call into question, or by review, are we suggesting that it must be a process similar to this that we would have to go through?
Did you, I'm assuming I just didn't hear, did you state your name for the recording?
Sure, Molly McGarrick, Delaware.
May I respond to you?
Yes.
Yeah. My intent was my intent was that the subject would come up for discussion, and it might be as limited a discussion as we did a month or so ago when we kind of went around the room and said, does anybody have an interest in talking about the fall? But it would send a signal to the various states that if you are serious about wanting to come up front, you should start getting prepared because there will be an opportunity coming up in 3 years or 4 years, start getting your ducks in a row, talk to people. But if there really is no need to change, we'll go around the room and everybody can say, no, we don't want to waste that much time on the discussion. I was not saying that we were committing to a formal, or I'm not intending to commit us to a formal application public hearing process as much as a guarantee that we will, in fact, raise the subject very specifically.
Any other views on either side of this question?
So I think I'm actually a little agnostic on this question, David, but I will say this. I appreciate the sentiment that it sends the signal that no one is sacrosanct in this process, right? That this is an evergreen process to make sure that each cycle we've got the right window consistent with our values. What I like about putting aside the clarifications that I think are very, some of which are great clarifications that we've discussed so far, but what I like so far about this framework is that it's more of a statement of values that are evergreen to the party. Right? It doesn't say competitiveness in 2020. Right, as defined by the 2020 Act, it just says competitiveness. It doesn't say diversity based on the demographics in 2024, right? And so with time, with each passing cycle, this committee can take stock of whether or not the most recent states in the early window adhere to these values as we've defined them and decide whether or not to make adjustments. I think that is the key here. I don't know if I agree that it's necessary that we have to explicitly state, because I do agree with the chair that this is something we can do at any time, but I do think it is important that it reflects that this can happen, that this review process can happen at any time as we do a gut check as a committee and as a party, that the states in the early window are consistent with these values, which based on everything we've talked about are sort of our evergreen values in this process. So I applaud and I agree with the need to make sure that is clear, that this is, that no one is locked. Once we make the decision for 2024, that is not necessarily locked for all subsequent cycles. But if we decide we want to do it next cycle again, because some states might have shifted, or some new state may come in with a better case to make, I think making that point clear is good.
And that was why I put it at least once, as opposed to once every decade, but at least once, so we can do it any time. But we're saying at least once every 10 years or so, we're going to make sure that everything is still aligned with our values, even if we haven't noticed it until some other reason.
Okay, thank you both. Mr. Leon.
Yes, frankly and quickly, I agree with Mr. Elfie's statement, but I think the tying this at least once review to the census, maybe it states the impression that we're actually only going to do it in earnest once every 10 years. If we want to make a point that we can and will re-examine this as part of our delegate selection rules every cycle, which we should, I mean, we'll make decisions this time. They might have turned out to be wrong. We'll take a hard look at it in 4 years. I think if we want to clarify that, I would be in favor of that. But I still have a problem with linking this to a 10-year cycle. Thank you.
So let me ask you, David. I hear what Frank's saying about it's not really related to the census. Do we want to apply that in the details? Now, maybe you really want that in there because we do learn demographic things in the census. But is your message really, there needs to be an in-depth review roughly every decade? Is that what your message really is?
There were two messages. One of them was there is a periodic review, and we're going to specify something about the period. But the reason I picked the census is I think once we've made a decision, we do need a reason to change. I'm not advocating change solely for the sake of change, because if I was, we would simply put the states in a hat, draw the front four, and pick them every time. But if our concern is, do the front four states adequately represent the country and the democratic base in the country, then we know that every 10 years we get information from a third-party source that we may or may not agree with, but that tells us whether the composition of the four states that we have up front is still generally reflective of the population as a whole, or whether it's out of whack. And so in that sense, I ticked it to the census, but I didn't want to compel us to change the state. Simply, we need to have a check in the rearview mirror, not just in the rearview mirror, but maybe in the out the front windshield as to where these trends are going and are the states that we have.
So, understanding that you mean what you said. So, any further discussion on this amendment? Let's take a vote on this amendment. And just because, since I am the sole chair here, I won't. Normally, the chair doesn't vote unless there's a tie, as they're expressing opinion. I want to say, hearing this discussion, I've actually come to being persuaded that this is a pretty good idea. More in terms of the general message than in terms of a dogmatic requirement. So I just wanted to express that opinion to sort of
counteract what I said earlier. That being said, all those, no, I could do that just by voting if I was voting, but I'm not. All those in favor of this amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
All say no.
No.
We're going to do a show of hands, I think. If you want to vote aye, please raise your hand.
The only thing I want to say is, yes, we we nominally review this every 4 years, but if you are not on this committee, and if you are not on the front four states, I bet you don't really realize that we review it every 4 years. I bet it was a surprise to many of the states out there that we might suddenly be taking up the reopening window this time. And so I think sending the signal that at least once a decade, so if we haven't reviewed it, we will eventually get to it, is a good idea. That's the reason I put it in. The rest of her comments did not mention my name, so I will not say anything.
Defined by the DNC parentheses. state that again. Geographic diversity, parentheses, including a mix of rural and urban voters, comma, and including but not limited to one state from each of the four regions of the country as defined by the DNC, parentheses.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. We have a discussion on this amendment.
If I could just speak to that. I really appreciated Carol's bringing this up. I think we would all agree that whatever five states are included in this window, we want to make sure that we are reflective of each of the wonderful regions of this country. All of them have competitive battlegrounds. All of them are important to our presidential nominee, whoever that is. And I just wanted to ensure that at a minimum it was clear that each region will be represented during this early state window. And I know that there seems to be a lot of heads shaking here, so hopefully this will pass. But, you know, I don't know what's going to happen here with Iowa or any other Midwestern state, but I think it's important that the Midwest does not fly over the country. And so thank you for the consideration.
Anyone else want to speak on the Martin Amendment? Mr. Leone.
Yes, I think the four regions make sense. I'm a little concerned about tying it to the DNC because, for example, Virginia is in the south, although some people might think of Virginia in the east, depends. So I don't know if there's any traps given the DNC definition to make it clear we're talking about the four regions of the country. I've been fine with that. But if you're, that's just my thought.
Well, I guess I would defer to Jim on this, but everything we do within the DNC is defined by those regions and not how the country defines those regions, to your point. And so we'd be somewhat inconsistent with our other rules that have been promulgated here if we weren't actually defining them by the same standards the DNC is currently doing. And so I would recommend we stay with that. I don't disagree with you. I mean, Oklahoma is considered part of the Midwest. I'm glad they are. Point being is that I don't know who makes those, but we have a lot of rules that are promulgated already under that current construct. I would suggest we stay with them.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, just for the record, I take a great offense. Susan Swepper, Chair of Virginia, and it still is like fingernails on a blackboard to me when I'm put in the Mid-Atlantic and not part of the South. I just want to go on the record for that. I'm here in the South.
Always spoken to the need to ensure that we expand participation, but we also understand that we had to overcome so much to get where we are. So I just really want to put back in there racial and ethnic diversity.
Second that.
So you want to make a motion to include the words racial and?
Yes.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any debate? Hearing none, all those in favor,
It's not debate, but it is a question. I had understood from the previous discussion that there might be further work being done in this resolution and the wording of that particular section before we actually took the vote on it. It was in order to make sure that we were not excluding the other groups that we worry about encouraging to participate in the party. And if that's still happening, I don't have any problem with highlighting racial diversity.
There will still be further review tonight before we go back tomorrow. But I think we want to consider it tonight in a form as close to what people are comfortable with as possible. So.
I would be happy to support Donna's motion, but when it's done, I would like to then make a formal amendment that we make reference to the charter groups with respect to full participation, so that it would be including the groups mentioned in here, so-and-so, and to promote racial and ethnic diversity.
Why don't we take Ms. Brazil's motion by itself, and then if you want to further suggest that they get the memo, we'll do that. Okay. Anything, any further discussion on Ms. Brazil's motion? Now appears on the screen. Rachel Mayer. All right, hearing no further discussion, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. Now let's go to the next slide.
I would perhaps say diversity colon and then insert language as required by Article 8, Section 3 of the Charter, comma, including but not limited to racial and ethnic diversity, and so on. I'm inserting a reference to the full charter list as being the diversity we're considering.
David, can I just make this all clear? Because I think I'm Brazil. I don't think anybody in this room has sat down and seen more people come through this door than many of us who have worked to increase the diversity, the representation of every single American, every eligible voter. But I just want to constantly remind you that this is a party that had to be taken to every possible court and every state in order to include racial and ethnic diversity. We had a Voting Rights Act, although it's been weakened. I just want us to be clear, as I've said over the years, that we had a Voting Rights Act that ensured that no American would ever be denied the right to vote. Now, and of course that act was included, was amended for language minorities, etc. We all know the history of the Voting Rights Act. But I am afraid that every time we bring up racial and ethnic diversity, somehow or another we get into this conversation that we exclude. We're not. We're just making sure the pie is open to everybody and everybody's included. And this is not about excluding. It's about making sure that this party stands for the principles that it has fought for. So that's why I constantly remind us of what Lyndon Johnson did. Because his leadership and the leadership of those who marched, who died, the martyrs, across that Pettus Bridge. That's the group that I want to make sure that we constantly focus on. We haven't arrived yet. And when you look at the 19 states with 342 laws that have been proposed, there's still
So that's why I make it that point. And if I'm lost, for those of you who know how to deal with it better, fine. But I just want to make sure that when you see me add ratio, there's a reason for that. There's a moment that we will never forget. And that's why I wanted to make sure it's included. That's it. Because what we're witnessing now with these Republicans, and yes, I said who they are. What they're trying to do to take us back to pre-1965, I'm not going to stand for it, nor should this party.
Starting with Carol's. I think the
Carol, under C1, the feasibility of scheduling a pre-window contest, I think that goes to your last point. I think we have to bear in mind what the situation is of the primaries on the books. Is a state legislature willing to move up? I mean, that's got to be part of the presentation. It's got to be part of our calculation. I mean, if the state party comes to us and says, yeah, I'd like to be first, and we don't have any indication from the Speaker of the House, right, that they would move a bill to go first if they have to move their primary, then I think that that's something that is covered in here and we're going to have to talk about. So I think one of the messages, and I think one of the reasons to have this meeting is to put some meat on the bones of 4A, B, and C, because the state parties need to know, you know, sort of what to expect. So a state party shouldn't even, whoever makes the decision, Jim, I guess it'll be you and the chair on who we hear from, that's gotta be one of the things, right? There's gotta be some indication that, yeah, they can do this, they can move it to February or whatever. Secondly, I want to talk about feasibility, because this has been, we haven't talked about this piece of it very much. Scheduling a pre-window contest I just talked about. Run a fair, transparent, inclusive nominating process. I think let's be perfectly clear. In my mind, this means no traditional caucus states in the early lineup. And I want to say that very clearly, given my great love of Iowa. I've been to a lot of caucuses. I think it's a remarkable exercise in small d democracy, but I think the time has passed. The amount of people, the amount of attention going to these early states is such that we are looking at systems that were built for 30 or 40,000 participants that now have a 250,000 participants. Washington State and Minnesota got rid of their caucuses last time around under pressure from Unity Commission. I think particularly in the early states, they will not meet number two. And so I'm just going to say flat out, I don't think caucuses can be in this early mix. Similarly, I do not think party-run primaries can be in this early mix. Because among other things, a party-run primary does not have the whole mechanism for recounts that we get in state-run primaries. And all the states, like whether you like it or not, they do have an established mechanism, an established legal history for doing a recount. These early states are extremely important. People can test them strongly, and because it's early in the system, you do get close results. You do get. And it is close in some of these states in some years. So therefore, I'm going to include in this, not only should we not be looking at caucus states, we should not be looking at party-run primaries in this early. And then finally, this, we haven't talked about this at all, the cost of logistical requirements of campaigning in state. And this goes right to the presidential candidates and presidential campaigns. Looking back, When the Winograd Commission, which was the first time we established a window, we thought about a window, there was a lot of discussion about the importance of retail campaigning. And I still think this is an argument we need to put in the mix and think about. The argument was in Iowa, but especially in New Hampshire, which has a century of experience in this, was that if you didn't start in a small state that was accustomed to retail campaigning, we wouldn't get the experience of having people who would be president actually interacting with real human beings. If you started in California, you would interact with television anchors and radio announcers. It's too big. That's the way it has to be. And so there has been this, maybe it's a romantic notion, and I'm just going to put it out here. It may be romantic, but there is this notion of the early states should show some retail campaigning. And the press has traditionally loved the early states, particularly New Hampshire, for the fact that the voters take it very seriously.
And the press gets to watch these people who would be president actually dealing with voters. Once you get out of there, once you get to Super Tuesday, and all you have to do is think of Gary Hart in 1984 and comes in, basically drives an auto into New Hampshire and leaves with two 747s filled with reporters, right? Once you get out of New Hampshire, it's a national campaign. And so we have to think about what these early states, what kind of campaigns you run in these early states. If you start with a California, or a New York, or a New Jersey, okay, you are starting with a place that is a media campaigning place and where you need a lot of money. Michael Bloomberg might do really well buying some great ads in these states, okay, but you never see him campaigning people to people, you know, and in that kind of situation. So I think we have to think about what kind of presidential campaigns, what do we want to see about our candidates? What do we want to learn about them? And what do we want to learn about them in these early states? Because the early states, as we are not definitive, but boy, they sure do narrow the field, right? They sure do narrow the field. Now, I'm not totally in favor of having completely obscure and unknown candidates become the nominee of the party, right? And in fact, some may argue that that's a bad idea. That was, in fact, the argument way back in 1980 when people decided that they didn't much like the Jimmy Carter presidency, and he had been one of the first ones to emerge as an obscure candidate. On the other hand, I do think we have to be careful that we don't limit this field to people who come from states where they don't have big money behind them. At lunch, we talked about Steve Bullock, very capable governor. Poor guy couldn't get anywhere. I mean, in fact, I once worked for a guy named Bruce Babbitt for president, okay? And I learned the hard way that coming from the Mountain West, you just can't get any place. You don't have the money behind you, you don't have the media behind you, etc. So these early states have often given an opportunity to candidates who are not nationally known to get nationally known. And I think we want to think about keeping that here. And then I think there's the simple cost of campaigning. Much as Hawaii is a wonderful place, I love it dearly, we can't campaign in Hawaii. We can't strike this in Hawaii. It's too many time zones different in any respect. We can't start in New Jersey. Right? In New Jersey, you've got to buy New York City and Philadelphia media. That's as bad as one of these other big expensive states. So we've got to think about the campaigns and the candidates, because we don't want to get, we don't want everybody in our race. I mean, we have way too many people running as it is. But we don't want to tilt the field to only people who have already a national name and already, you know, billions and billions of dollars in the bank and can run. So we want to think about what kind of states are early. And finally, back to Carol's question, the reason I think this went from 4 to 5, and I'm guessing here, is that we knew that everybody agrees that we need 4 regions. I mean, Ken, thank you for clarifying that, but I think everybody's kind of assumed we need to make it explicit. But then the question is, do we add in this early lineup a state that is a critical general election state? And back to David's point, electoral college, okay? So we're talking here about a handful of states, right? Every year, in fact, we get fewer and fewer states that are actually swing states in the general election. This year may be one of the lowest numbers ever. Some of the traditional early states, Nevada and New Hampshire, are, in fact, swing states. But there was also a thought of perhaps adding another one. Now, maybe we shouldn't do it, because if we added another one and added a big state, we added Michigan, we added Wisconsin, which are some of the swing states people talk about. All right, we're then getting into big states in the early lineup. So I think those are all things that we have to think about. And we haven't yet addressed the question of the presidential campaigns and presidential candidates. And what do we want to see from them? What do we want to learn from them? One big advantage of not having a national primary, which is why we've never had it, and the party has always been against it, is that when you have a sequence like we do, you can learn about the candidates along the way. You know, some do well, some drop out, some don't do, some do better than others. We have a little bit of a learning period. And we have a fail-safe at the end. The fail-safe at the end is, in the end, guess what? Hard to believe, but people are always surprised at this, the delegates actually decide the nomination, not the primary voters. So if you discover, you know, in the 3 weeks before the convention that there's something seriously wrong with your presidential candidate, the delegates at the convention can change the outcome of the primaries. And that's been our rules ever since 1980. We say in all good conscience, the delegates can not vote for the person they were elected to vote for. So we need to think of this as a whole long process that begins in these early states, but then actually ends at the convention. And there could be a lot of dynamism, right, and a lot of change over the period of that, you know, what is basically half a year. So those are a lot of them.
So those are all very important factors for both the co-chairs and then this full committee to consider. I don't take it that you're proposing an actual amendment to this resolution.
No, no. And one of the things I think we want to do here is put some meat on the bones to what some of these things mean, right? I mean, when we say the cost and logistical requirements of campaigning in state, you know, I mean, we're talking about, well, okay, do we really, really expensive media markets? If we picked four early states that had hugely expensive media markets, we're going to cut out some people. Okay, you know, maybe I'm burned by my Bruce Bannon experience, who was such a wonderful guy and I thought would have been a great president, but boy, oh boy, he could not at all raise the money. I couldn't even sleep in Pennsylvania for him. I mean, that's how out of it small state governors are, even when they're very talented and very good. So I think we've got to pay attention to these early states and not make them automatically cut out certain candidates, because then you might as well have a national primary.
Okay.
I still have a piece of my question.
All right, Ms. Fowler.
Piece of my question was, are we going to pick the dates and then pick the states and try to plug them in? Are we going to say to the states, make your proposal and tell us which of these dates work for you? Are we going to choose four or five states and then try to move them around? And you've chosen Vermont, and Vermont says, we can only manage to do this on the first Wednesday in January. I'm asking about our process.
So what we've done in the past is we have specified the order in which the early states have to go. Mm-hmm. I don't think
We were bound by Iowa and New Hampshire.
We were bound by Iowa and New Hampshire, so then we had the other two. I don't think we specified specific dates, but as you say, when we were that down to just those two, it was easier to resolve. If we should end up not being bound by Iowa and New Hampshire, and that's a very big if, there's nothing in this resolution that would require us to specify specific dates. There's nothing to stop us from doing that.
We're going to have to, we don't want to put two on the same day, presumably.
We don't want two on the same day. And we may well want a particular order as well. So I think we don't have to resolve that before this motion, but it's something that we should know. We ultimately will have to resolve. And Mr. Brennan? No? Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Already gone through the battle. it's laid out here, but it's not very specific. And I think that we have to... Oh, sorry, Kim. Sorry. Okay, sorry. So I think that it would be helpful to know if what we're doing with this resolution is to also set what a threshold of an application would look like. And those specifics that you added were very specific. And if that is to be included, is it proper to put it in the resolution? Or is it proper to put in the application process, which I don't think we've discussed yet, because we're still going through this component.
So, that's why I tried to clarify that those were factors to be considered. They're not specifications.
That's right.
In the resolution. They're not necessarily going to be, every state has to check all those boxes. Those are, I think, being advocated as factors for both the co-chairs and the full committee, all committee consider.
Okay.
Yeah, that's exactly what
I'm talking about. Okay. And then another thing, thinking about the five states, and as we were considering Chairman Martin's amendment of the regions, not limited to one per region, it also brought up the question for me in my mind was the five question one, but also two, thinking about the calendar itself, so it kind of still goes to Ms. Fowler's question, are we then open to expanding that window if in fact there's a potential of five? So, and again, it's a question, and I'm just proposing, I'm just asking that question, because it's sort of like just, what is the domino effect?
So remember that this Rules and Bylaws Committee can move beyond this resolution if it decides to. So I don't think we have to specify whether we might change the calendar in terms of expanding the pre-window or something like that. But I think that there's nothing in here that says we will or should do that if somebody wants to raise that later. Mr. Spade.
Couple of things. Dennis Spade, Texas. Couple of things on, I had the same similar question that Carol did about, is it necessary to stay five? Do we want the maximum flexibility? I'm not saying we go 6, 7, 8, 9, I'm just, do we even need to specify five? Because in light of Ken's righteous amendment, four regions being covered, one per, somebody's going to get an extra advantage unless we treat D.C. by itself. So that's an open question. To Elaine's point on C2, ability to run fair, transparent, inclusive nominating process, she was very clear about caucuses. I'm going to paraphrase a little bit. Caucuses need not apply. And I'm wondering if we want to go that far in this resolution. And go ahead and say those are the questions.
So that is not in the resolution now, and we don't have a formal amendment to put it in the resolution. We have basically advocacy for that as consideration. Someone wants to make that motion, we can entertain it, but we don't have that. Yes.
Molly, thank you, Mr. Chair. Look, I support this resolution with all the great clarifications that it will make. I support it because I think it is a clear articulation of our values that we think should determine the calendar. But I also support it because it gives this committee, I think, significant, close to maximum flexibility when it comes to the state selection process. I actually don't think we should put a lot more meat on the bones in this resolution. I think that's going to have plenty of time for that later. Here's what I want to say, right? Elaine, sister, like you and I are right there on the primary versus caucus question. It is going to take a really strong effort for a really compelling case for a caucus to convince me. But I want them to make a case, and they might prove me wrong, and I want that flexibility to be proven wrong. I also don't think there are going to be a ton of states that apply. I like that this is a framework and not criteria. I don't know that if this was criteria, I don't know how many states would actually be able to check every box, right? And so to have this flexibility of looking at these values, we may have states that apply that meet most of these items, but are often one of them, and if their overall piece is compelling, great. We may want to put them in the window. I don't think we want to say any state need not apply. I think we want to give every state the chance to make the most compelling case, and then we as committee members will know which of these factors are most important to us. I will say it right now. Caucus states are going to be on board itself. I will say it right now, states that don't offer some form of diversity are going to be a hard sell for me. But there may be states that can convince me that I'm willing to overlook some of that because the rest of their case is so compelling as to how they fit into the framework. So I think we should be going into this process with as much flexibility as we possibly can. And I applaud those who put pen to paper, put together a resolution that I think doesn't. I actually think having up to five is great because it gives us that flexibility. I don't know that I support more, right? But it gives us that flexibility, and I think that's what we want. I want to put the onus on the states after this week. After this week, I want to put the onus on the states. They now have a sense as to what our vision is for what that window should look like. Now, states, come tell us how you fit into that vision.
And it puts people on notice that we could go that way, but if we did go that way, we can't say, what?
That's right.
All right, does anyone have any further specific points they'd like to amend? Okay, we have Mr. Brennan and Mr. Curry.
Thank you, Scott Brennan. I agree with some, and this is my sum, but what most of it. I do think that, I think that this is a document where we're just looking for the flexibility to go forward and let people apply, let them make their case. I think that it would be entirely wrong-headed to just get rid of a process which has proven to be very successful in many election cycles on the front end. So let's be general and let everyone make their case and we'll let the chips fall where they may.
Thank you. Mr. Kerr, actually, let me go to Ms. Dugdell first, if I may, and then Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Joanne Dugdell. I just have a recommendation for a change of word. We say principles and procedures for review, and in my mind, procedures mean more meat on the bone. So we've referenced and used framework. I would suggest that we say principles and framework for review in the title on page 4, the subtitle.
I actually like that change. But I said before, we're not doing regulations.
Right.
That's what we're not doing. Right. Is there any objection to modifying that? Okay, we will change that. Okay. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think there's been some healthy discussion here today, and that was premised on the discussion that we had last month to bring this framework to the resolution. I would have to agree with Mo. I'm in full support of where we've gotten. I think there's been good discussion, maybe a couple amendments just here. Here's I think we're starting to get to a point now that we're talking about more process and procedural type items. And I think we're going to also gather great information out of the listening sessions to be able to make sure that we can make a healthy decision around that. I would support being able to actually move forward with voting on the actual resolution itself and allowing the proper discussion of the procedural and process items to take place, separate and apart from that. Because I think that, I think we're getting into that type of discussion now that's beyond the actual passage of the resolution itself that's in front of us.
So if I hear you correctly, you want to actually move this resolution so that we can go to a vote?
Absolutely, Mr. Chair.
Second.
Is there a second? There is a second for Mr. Spade. It was moved and seconded at the beginning, an hour and a half ago. Amendments, we actually have a motion on the floor. What I take it you are doing, Mr. Curry, is calling the question.
Calling the question again, Mr. Chair.
all right, I'm going to ask you to withdraw that for just a minute while Ms. Weingarten speaks.
Thank you. I appreciate Mr. Curry and my colleagues' sentiments. I just want to. I just wanted to say I completely support the resolution, and particularly the thinking about it as a framework, and will vote yes on it as amended. I think it creates a transparent process, and I think that what we need to do as a committee is allow that transparent process with all of its kind of guardrails to be in place. I think that it's that we have to be careful to not read into it more flexibility than it has, because it should be this kind of transparent process to the states that have these kind of guardrails, and that gives the committee, the Rules and Bylaws Committee, and the chairs a way of then bringing to all of us sense of prioritization on states. Because what happens if 30 states apply? What happens if 50 states apply? It's, so I think that we should be, it would be great if 10 states apply, and after the listening sessions and all of that, we have a sense of, what we should do and what we should propose as a Rules and Bylaws Committee to the DNC. But I just would be careful right now in terms of who we are, of wearing our inclinations on our sleeves before we actually go through this process. I think it's a really good process. I think what we've come out with is really smart, but it is transparent, and it enables every state who fits these guidelines to apply, and then for us to carefully consider that. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Curry.
Chair, call for a question.
Is there a second? All those in favor of calling the question, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. All right. So having moved faster than I thought we possibly could, we are ready to vote on the resolution as amended. The word framework, by the way, which we changed on page 4, we're also going to change on page 1. We can't do it on the screen for a technical reason. We'll do it afterwards, but everyone should just be aware of that. So, framework rather than procedures. All right, the question has been called. Does anyone have any questions about the content of the resolution at this point, because we could read it? I don't hear any questions, so we will proceed to a vote.
And the motion carries. So, this has been very meaningful participation this afternoon. I personally believe, and I think I'm not speaking just for myself, that this is a powerful resolution of a thoughtful process that is going to be inclusive of all Democrats. And that's our goal. We will send a notification to state parties within 7 days outlining the process to apply. You can do that, can't you? We will be sure you all receive a copy of this notification as well. We will ask that state parties submit a letter of intent to the Party Affairs and Delegate Selection staff by May 6th if they are interested in participating. This will not be a hard or fast commitment that they will apply. It will just give us a smaller group of interested states to organize around. The actual application deadline will be June 3. We will indicate demographic information and descriptions that the state party should begin compiling based on the parameters expressed in this resolution and in today's discussion. I say, looking at Mr. McDonald, even though he's not looking at me. We will have We will have time at our May 18 meeting to determine whether there's anything else you'd like to include. But before I move to the next date, would any member like to share what they would like to see in the state's applications that we discussed today? I think that's something I plan to ask at this point, but I think we've done that. Mr. Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ken Mark from Minnesota. I mentioned this sort of to Veronica in a previous conversation, just about trying to be a little bit more prescriptive about what the letter of intent should include or not include. And again, just in the spirit of not trying to waste any state's time, I would hate for a state to feel like that process of sending in a letter is in fact their full bid. What does a letter of intent entail? Is it a one-page letter? Is it a 10-page bid? Again, I raise the question because I think some prescriptive answer here is going to be important for those states that are interested in knowing what they need to submit right now at this time to be considered as part of this process, knowing that there will be another round where I believe the intention is they would, if they're chosen, would be to submit a more comprehensive bid.
So I'm going to return to what I said a couple of minutes ago, and I think it's good to clarify that this is the intent of what we will be undertaking. We're going to ask states to submit a letter of intent by May 6th stating whether they're interested in participating in the early window process. We will specify that it is not a hard and fast commitment to apply. It will just be indicated the number of interested states. The factors that we've talked about today will be for the June 3rd formal application. We promise in the resolution at least 28 days from now to submit an application, so that's covered. We actually are able to afford states a bit more time than that, and that's why we're saying June 3rd. Joanne.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Joanne Dowdell. In the application process, will we provide a standard document that should be completed by all states that have submitted their interest in the process to participate in the process?
So we will provide a standard document with categories. It's not going to be a checklist. Did you do this? Do you not do that? So there will be categories within which they can specify what their intent is. And
then they will have this resolution. And actually, I think we could offer, if they wanted, a transcript or a summary of today's discussion so that they get a sense of what they think about.
I guess, just for further clarification, as far as what we're going to receive, do we want some sort of standardization so it is easy to review and evaluate each application?
Well, the trouble is that each state, I mean, we could do something that was really a checklist, but each state doesn't have to pass muster on each item. And I think if you get very prescriptive in the application, it's going to look like that's what you have to do. And let us work on what that looks like, and maybe I will give you the final answer right now.
Okay.
I understand where you're going. It has to be enough so that there's comparability and it's easy to review. It has to be not so much that it says, if you don't meet this, don't bother filling it out.
Mr. Chair?
Does that make sense?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Can I speak to that for a second? I think if I'm looking at these, right, you know, most of them are guidelines for how to persuade us, right? Okay. I think there's one issue here, though, that isn't a sort of persuasion. It's more of a yes-no kind of thing, and it goes to, I think, Carol's, one of the things Carol was worried about. If a state does not have an early primary date, and there is no indication of interest on the part of their legislature to funding a separate presidential primary or moving up their own primary date, then we really shouldn't bother. And they shouldn't bother. They shouldn't spend the time on it. It's Ken's point about, you know, they've got other things to do, et cetera. So I'm just wondering if that, and you might be able to do it informally, the staff might be able to call them, but, you know, a state may decide that they want to do this and they can come to Washington and make a great presentation about how wonderful their state is, et cetera. But if the state's not going to appropriate money for an early contest, forget it, you know? I mean, just forget it. There's just no point doing this. So that's the only thing here going, I think, Joanne, to your question about what, you know, what should be put, that we ought to kind of figure out early, because it could narrow down the number of states that apply and save them and us a lot more.
So that fits with what you're advocating in terms of it needs to be a state-run primary process. But we're not setting that as an absolute requirement. We need to know that it may be influential and persuasive to us, but we're not setting that as an answer. So what we will do is we will ask them to specify whether it is a state-run process, whether it is a party-run caucus, whether it is a party-run primary.
And then if it is a state-run process, right, then we need to ask, well, is your law already on the books for this? Or is it, did you have some good indication that it could be changed?
That's good.
Yeah,
good,
because I think that's
it. Feasible to get it moved to that.
Is it feasible to get it? Yeah.
Or will they?
Yeah, because, you know, there's so many states, let's face it, all politics is local. You run into this in presidential primaries all the time. All politics is local. There's an awful lot of states that have the primary dates the way they have them for local reasons, not for presidential reasons. So, and every once in a while, the state, Massachusetts, will cough up the money to have a different presidential primary than the rest of its primaries. But a lot of states don't want to do that. So we ought to know that right up front.
Massachusetts loves to hold elections. California is not, that's why they do things in June.
What?
Massachusetts loves to run elections. California does not, which is why they do things all together in June.
Right. Exactly.
All right, so that will be in there. Yes, I got it. Reverend Dodger. No. Before I get to Reverend Dodger, Mr. McRitchie has
I was not advocating for this, but I just asking, would there be any technical assistance to the state available from a staff perspective on this application process in your view?
There is always technical assistance available to the states. This is not a procurement process.
Okay.
They can have a discussion, they can get guidance, and almost every time we have a filing, we do that. And we definitely do that with the delegate selection committees. So they're kind of, those states that have consistent staff are used to that. All right, now, where is your doctor? There she is! I don't know why I didn't see you over there. All right.
I'll pass because Elaine made the points that I was going to make.
Pardon me?
I said Elaine made the points that I was going to make, so I'll pass.
So Elaine has made your points?
Yes.
Okay. All right. It's a wonderful thing when everything is said and you don't have to say it again. Do we have Mr. Dow, Ms. Dow down?
Joanne Dowdell again. Knowing how critical this election cycle is, that we have an uphill climb, and this process may give some candidates in hotly contested races an opportunity to sort of flex a little bit, going to push for our state to be number one. If we get 30 applications, will we consider 30?
Yes.
Will we hear from 30 states? Will we hear from 30 states?
If we get 30, we will not hear off of you. We recommend to this committee a feasible number to hear from. If this committee is full, wants to expand on that number, we can do that. We'll be recommending it to you. Could be 5, could be 4, could be 7 or 8. Any other questions? Just to finish the summary of what we're doing today, we set a deadline of 6 weeks after the deadline of application. That means that at the point when we announce the results for our evaluation, that means that July 15th, that is July 15th, but it means but we will be meeting in July and we'll determine the pre-window states at that time. Before the announcement of early states, we will invite a subset of state parties to publicly present, as we've just said. That will be during our June 22-25 meeting. So that's for everybody. So in summary, states will be notified about this opportunity within 7 days. We will request a simple and confidential letter of intent due on Friday, May 6th. We will request preliminary information from those states based on the resolution that we've adopted and the comments discussed today. And then on May 18th, we will meet again and consider any additional information we'd like to request. States will submit their applications no later than June 3rd. They will present to this committee between June 22 and June 25. And we will select the early states at our July 8 and 9 meeting. So there it is. Any questions? Okay. Now, it being few minutes before 6 o'clock, we have other topics to discuss, but I think we can carry them over to tomorrow morning. Well, so we have the room till 6:30. Does that mean we don't have dinner until 6:30?
What about grants?
So let's go on for a little while. Because why stand around before the drinks are ready? Okay. All right. So what we've done is lay the keystone for our nominating calendar. We have a lot ahead of us as we draft topics that any of you think we need to discuss going forward? You'll think of them later, but at the moment, those are the key ones, I think. Let's talk about rules enforcement. Pardon me? Rules enforcement?
Rules enforcement?
Yes.
Okay.
Let's talk about rules enforcement.
Jim?
Sorry, go ahead.
I did have one that hopefully we will discuss during the process, which is clarifying what it means to suspend a campaign versus withdraw a campaign, and what impact that has on delegates that have previously been won, and what impact it has on your share of at-large delegates, because that was a touchy subject in the last campaign, as I recall. And you probably should be clear in the rules.
All right, let's add that to the list. Anyone else? Yeah, let me know if you think of other things. Ms. Blanco.
Not party Blanco, Nevada. Are we talking about, you're asking for other topics. I just wanted to double check. Is it for any of the documents that we're going to be reviewing? Or will we be discussing, or will we be discussing delegate selection plan questions tomorrow? Or is now the time I have a request?
For
so my question is, as we begin the process of reviewing the delegate selection rules, is I'd like to see some research or request some information from the staff to prepare for the next sets of meetings, is how which states, how can I say this correctly, the district level delegates that are elected with each state to their convention, state conventions, if we can have a list of are those state senate district levels, like which states are senate district levels, which states are congressional districts, if that is some information that we can be used for the next set of meetings when we review the delegate selection.
So you're saying, when will we review the...
Sorry, forget that question. I'm making my request for information for our next set of meetings.
So you're not requesting a discussion here on that?
No, sorry, this was the wrong place to bring this up.
Okay.
I just was wanted to make sure.
That's all right. That. We'll put that on the list for something new.
Yes, sorry. Right. Thank you. Thank you.
Take it off for you. All right.
What did you want to discuss about enforcement?
So that's
okay.
In particular, what happens should the RBC find that a state party's delegate selection plan is in non-compliance with three important rules? First one being timing. Has the state set the date of its first determining step outside of the window? Second one being proportional representation. What if the state's plan provides for a method of allocating delegates to presidential candidates that does not comply with Rule 14? Which provides for delegates to be allocated in a way that fairly reflects the results of a primary province. And thirdly, threshold. Does the state's plan permit the use of something other than 15% as the threshold for determining if a presidential candidate is qualified to receive an allocation of delegates? So I'm going to review what Rule 21 currently says about automatic sanctions, but do you have something you'd like to mention first?
No.
Okay. So right now, should the RBC find that a state's plan is in non-compliance with any of these three primary rules, let's say principal rules, Rule 21 contains automatic sanctions that reduce the number of pledged delegates elected in each category allocated to the state by 50%. Those of you who were on this committee in 2008 will remember that. Secondly, Rule 21 provides
contains a mistake found in non-compliance. Again, if you look back to 2008, that was a key enforcement mechanism, because it led to the campaigns essentially enforcing our rules. And what happened, and what it meant was that candidates who campaigned in states that were non-compliant could not receive any pledged delegates or delegate votes from that state. If the state is found in violation of the timing rule, candidates are allowed to campaign in the state only after the first determining step has already occurred. And finally, under Rule 21, not finally, but under Rule 21, these sanctions are effective immediately upon determination by this committee that the state's plan is in non-compliance with one or more of the primary rules. Rule 21 then allows the Rules and Bylaws Committee to impose additional sanctions on state parties for non-compliance, including setting up the DNC's own process in the state for conducting a delegate selection process. And that might seem very unlikely, but we actually worked on plans for that in one state. Another example is further reducing the state's delegation beyond the 50% cut. Reducing or eliminating the state's representation on the convention standing committees. Reducing or eliminating any guest or other credentials for the convention. Changing the assignment of the delegation's seating location and changing the assignment of the delegation's housing for the convention. Now we're getting down to the real nitty-gritty. Rule 21 does allow a state party to show that it took provable positive steps and acted in good faith to bring any state laws into compliance with our rules. In this case, the RBC may allow all or a portion of the automatic sanctions to be reduced. So I'd like to ask Carol Fowler to talk about these enforcement provisions. When Carol previously served as co-chair of this committee, she helped write and fine-tune the enforcement provisions of Rule 21. Carol, would you like to comment?
I will comment a little bit on my children and grandchildren think of me as an enforcer. And so I will always support enforcing whatever rules there are. But the specific piece of this enforcement that I actually had something to do with is this small C1B, I guess it is, that makes the presidential candidate responsible for doing part of our enforcement. And I don't know if you have this in front of you, but it is a long old piece, and it was written originally almost in these same words on a cocktail napkin on an airplane coming to approve the Bylaws Committee meeting, and the committee changed very little of what I had written on every little corner of that napkin. But although I think maybe it has been altered, yes, this is how big it was. But in reading over it a little while ago, I see a couple of places that maybe I would like to amend when we get to it. But this, five or six, we had some states that were had sort of decided that they would rather go early outside the window than have delegates. It was more important to them to have their process early with all the attendant hoopla that and the Republicans have actually done this in some states, but some states were talking about doing this, and we were trying to figure a way to enforce our window, and the presidential candidates truly did not want any more states outside the window. So we needed a way to take care of the candidates in that way. So I wrote this rule to make the candidates the enforcers, and it simply says if a state is in violation of timing, if the candidates campaign in that state, the candidates get no delegates, can have no delegates from that state. So they then were, the candidates were quite willing to stay out of those states because they had, we had their backs on this. And it may be possible if we decide we need some more enforcement provisions in here to make candidates responsible for some more of it. Because what we want to end up with rules that the candidates like. We want the candidates to feel like they benefit from our rules rather than that they're being punished by our rules. And so we might look at making the candidates the enforcers. They don't want to say no to a state. If you're a presidential candidate, you don't want to say no to a state about anything. But we gave them the backup on that. We said, oh gosh, don't do it. Don't go in that state because we won't let you have any delegates from that state, so you're wasting your time anyway. So that's how we did it. That specific thing. And it worked. It's worked so far, right? I don't think any of them have anything in one of the states since then have gone outside the window. Is that right, Rick? We had some things. It was tested in a way. This was tested. In the end and all worked out, we elected the president.
Jim? So, Elaine and then David.
I remember this well, Carol, and you're right. The secret to any of this is getting the presidential candidates to abide by our rules and what we say. And what was amazing about 2008 was that, in fact, by and large, they did, although there's a little backstory there too. But one of the issues that is constantly brought up is, oh, they say they're going to not let the delegates from these states vote, but then they do, in the end they do. And in the end, they did. However, what people always miss with that argument is, well, yeah, of course we do, because it was unanimous. There was only one person to vote for. By the time you get to a roll call, it's all done, you know? I mean, it's all finished, so sure. Florida, Michigan, they all got to cast their full votes. We may want to consider, and this has just occurred to me, so we got to think it through. We may want to consider, let me step back for a minute. If there is a contested convention, there is always a test vote, or two or three or four, right? And the test vote is generally over rules. This happens in both parties. It was the robot rule for Kennedy Carter. It was the Mississippi delegation for Reagan and Ford. You know, there's always a vote before the actual roll call. That's why we've had so few roll call votes in, you know, recent history that were contested. We may want to think about saying specifically that presidential candidates who from the delegates from states where presidential candidates, campaigned illegally or against all rules, are not allowed to vote on standing committee issues prior to the roll call. Because it's those votes on the standing committee issues, whether it's a credentials vote to seat a certain delegation, whether it's a rules committee vote, whether it's a platform vote, those tend to be the key critical votes. And so one more effective way of punishment is to say, you can't vote on those things. You're out of the votes on those things. And I think that might add some teeth to these, you see, because in the end, by the time we get to the roll call, even if it is contested, things are generally worked out. So that's just a thought.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. McDonough.
Yeah. So we had some discussion on this at the time when we adopted Carol's amendment. It was probably a more relevant, more difficult discussion now, namely, what does it mean to campaign in the state? Even in 2007, we worried a little bit about internet campaigning, but right now, a lot of the campaigning does not involve showing up in the state. If we're going to penalize a presidential campaign, they need a brighter line than us deciding after the fact the campaign. I don't have an answer to that question, but it's probably something we should discuss, and it may end up relating to, you can't spend money in the state, you can't buy advertising, I mean, advertising bleeds over from someplace else. But this was, I think, a large part of the reason that when we addressed board at Michigan, and when we revised the labyrinth, we made certain we took away all of the delegates, not just some, that there was no point to campaigning, so that we're not totally dependent on the campaigns going on. We made it just a waste of money to go and do it. And that is probably where we end up again, because if a large state decides to break the timing window, half of the large state's delegates is still 4 or 5 times what Iowa and Hampshire has. So we end up there. But the real critical problem is, what does it mean to campaign in the internet age in a state where physical presence is not necessarily a big driver except for raising money?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes,
sir. One thing I would say about 2008, you remember, neither candidate campaigned in the state. However, one candidate took their name off the ballot as an extra step, and the other candidate did not. And that led to the infamous May 31st, 2008 rules committee, where we had to decide what would happen to the delegates. So I think that is a point that needs to be clarified, and I would like to see that clarified in the rules about penalties and so forth, because in the end, that decision, depending on who you listen to, was consequential what happened to who became the nominee. So I think just the not campaigning in the state, we need to take the extra step of balloting the names that appear on the ballot in order to really talk about who wins the state, who loses the state, who participates, what participation is.
So this definition is up to us, and it's good to get it on the table here. I appreciate that. Yes,
thank you, Mr. Chair. One other area I want to throw out for consideration in terms of rule enforcement, because look, there may be some states that say it's worth it, right? Because we don't mind, because as Elaine pointed out to us in the last meeting, the early window is less about delegates as it is about momentum, right? So they might say, I'm willing to forego delegates in order to get this pop. So I do think it's important for us to consider other areas on top of delegates. And one area, I think, the DNC, for the first time really, actually has some leverage in, is debates. In 2004 and in 2008, the DNC lost control of the primary debate process, right? I mean, that was all driven by the now members. In 2016 and in 2020, the DNC really, for the first time, gained control of how many sanctioned debates there were, and they put enforcement mechanisms into that process to keep candidates from going and participating in rogue debates, right? If a candidate participated in an unsanctioned debate, they would lose, they would forfeit their invitation to future sanctioned debates. And that prevented candidates from working out deals with networks, at least through the early window. After the early window, all bets are over. We may want to consider something like that, at least worth discussing, whether one of these candidate-driven enforcement mechanisms could be, if a candidate campaigns, however we define them, campaigns in a state that's in violation of the early window, they won't get invited to the next sanctioned DNC debate.
So I get the power of that. We have been pretty careful in the past to wall off the debate process from this rules and bylaws committee and the delegate selection process. It's possible that we should not be the enforcers of that. It could be that whoever in the DNC, basically the chair, is determining that process could commit to following that sort of procedure. I think we need to think carefully before we do anything that doesn't mean that they should be totally unrelated. I get where you're going. But once we move in there, we then get subject to all sorts of pressure about how about a rule that.
I appreciate that.
Interesting idea, but I just add that.
And I totally appreciate that. I do think it is worth us exploring throughout this conversation other areas beyond delegate.
It's more definitely worth exploring, and people should keep thinking about that. And there's nothing that stops us from lobbying the chair,
right,
either. And indeed, one reason we were able to enforce our rules in 2008 is that while we may have lost control of the debate process, we had the full support of the chair in enforcing our rules. Any other topics that anyone would like to bring up at this point?
There's one. I just wanted to speak a little bit, and I promise it won't take long, about the state parties as far as delegate selection is concerned, because I think that we need to hear what the state parties go through with the delegate selection plans, and maybe make a couple of suggestions that might be helpful moving forward. So one of the things that we do in Maryland is we present the parameters, everything that will be used to determine how the delegate selection plan is going to be implemented in our state at our state meeting. And then we do we visit each individual county with a breakdown of exactly what will be involved with the delegate selection plan. And then after that, we did with the new reality that we had of doing everything virtually, we did webinars regularly so that people could tune in to understand exactly what went into the delegate selection plan. One of the advantages that we have that a lot of other states don't have is we have a person with institutional knowledge, Greg Pecoraro, who's on the DNC for years. He's also our parliamentarian, and he has done delegate selection plans even before I was state party chair. So he understands the process and he knows how to do that. A lot of state parties don't have that. As a matter of fact, a lot of state parties find themselves with all new staff after an election, and they've never done anything like this before. So I think it's really important for us to consider how we can be as helpful to these state parties as possible. One of the things that I constantly hear, and this is not a knock in any way because I know that everybody is busy, is accessibility to the party affairs staff. And I know you've got 900 million people coming to you asking for everything under the sun, and because you have a lot of new people who don't quite understand the process. But if there was a way to immediately, once the plans are on, the criteria, the call is sent out, that there should be some type of webinar with all of the EDs so that they understand exactly what's going on immediately. Don't wait until they, you know, get confused and try to figure out exactly what it is. There should be an immediate meeting with the EDs. Also, let them know exactly what it is they're responsible for. They don't have to rewrite everything, right? There are just certain things they need to plug in. And I think there's been confusion as far as that's concerned as well, because they think that they have to start from scratch, and they don't. Just fill in what is applicable to your state. One of the questions that we came up with the problems that we had, clear time frames of exactly when things are supposed to be in, what's supposed to happen at what particular time as it relates to your individual state. The other thing that I think we could probably have is regional office hours, where EDs could call from different regions. There would be a day of the week that would be the office hours that they would have access to the party affairs staff, right, to clear up any concerns that they have. So and this just would be as we are getting our sea legs as to how to do this. If you have chairs that have done it forever, they don't need to participate, but you will have new chairs and new EDs that will benefit from this type of discussion, and I think it's really important that we consider that.
that the biggest problem, not problem, but source of discussion, I'll say, that we had in Maryland was, and still is, over the non-binary issue. As much as we tried to clarify it, it just did not get clarified enough. So we really need to work on that language, because people didn't understand that they weren't being replaced by. And that was the constant thing, you know, it's going to take my place. That's not what it was designed to do. So that means if there was that much confusion, we need to work on that language better so that people understand exactly what that means and how it affects the ballot, because it is, as I said, still a source of confusion for a lot of our central committees. And then the last thing and the most important thing, I've sat in, even before I was on Rules and Bylaws, I would come to the Rules and Bylaws meetings. I know it's just something about this, but it's so exciting to me. But I would come to the Rules and Bylaws meeting. When you were doing delegate selection, and the number of plans that were returned was a concern, and it still is a concern. You know, we have to go back and redo this and redo that specifically as it relates to affirmative action goals. So it would seem to me, I don't know, I'm not a genius, but it would seem to me that the DNC has some idea of what those numbers should be in each state, right? And maybe give the states those parameters to work within, because what happens, we get the requirements and then we fill them out, you know, the states fill them out, they send them in with the best of intentions, thinking that everything has been done correctly, only to have it returned, and then the state party reworks it, and then we have to explain to the central committees why we had to rework it when, according to the central committees, what we put forth was already compliant. So I think that even in those office hours or even in those initial discussions, just some idea of what those parameters are as far as affirmative action is concerned, I think it would save us a lot of time when we get these plans, because they would be closer to the goals that we're trying to achieve for each individual state. So those are just some recommendations that I think we ought to consider as we start to work with these states to make sure that they have as much information as possible, keeping in mind that a lot of them are not institutional or legendary, like, you know, many of us here who have been doing this for a while, and they really do need that kind of hand-holding. So that's all I wanted to say.
So building on what you just raised, what I had planned to open with tomorrow is a discussion of how state plans are implemented within the states. And to call on those of you who have been state chairs and executive directors to comment on that. So you will be part of that group. Begin with a presentation. I'll go back to